The topic of today is turn data science into sustainability impact with data entrepreneurship. Who has ever heard about data entrepreneurship? None of you? Okay, well then it can be an interesting morning. But the main pitch of my story is that data won't save the world, but data entrepreneurship can. Just with data, not that much happens. But if you put spirit behind it, then a lot can happen. Briefly, my personal story. I studied economics and management sciences in Holland. I studied at Eindhoven University and also Tilburg University. And I was lucky to spend half a year abroad in the US on an MBA education. And then I started out at Philips. Well, most of you know Philips Electronics. And I can tell you that Philips now is a completely different company than it was then. Then the computer division of Philips was taken over by Digital Equipment. Who ever heard about Digital Equipment? Wow, two, even three. It was once the number two computer manufacturer in the world, taken over by Compaq and now HP. And there I worked on innovations in banking, electronic banking. And if we talk about data science and data entrepreneurship, I think electronic banking and also dealing rooms was already an early format of data entrepreneurship. Then I moved into the media world with MediaWare and KPMG. And I briefly was an entrepreneur myself by founding Profiles World. And I had the ambition to maybe compete with Google. It was in fact an early Facebook, but it was too early. It was 2002, can you imagine? That at these times everybody was working on that. But again, I was too early and I moved on in other companies. Then about 12 years ago, I went to Ortec, and Ortec stands for Operations Research Technologies. It's a mathematics company, and it has now 1,000 people worldwide, 16 countries. And it's really a pure data science company, focused on logistics. And in that world, I learned about sustainability, because one of the things we did was save a lot of fuel. On average, when we started the project, we were saving 10% of fuel spent on logistics by building better packages and by shortening the routes. But 2 years ago, I got the opportunity to stop at Ortec and to start in the academic world. And I thought, well, let's make a good career out of that, because I always did my marketing programs not by advertising, but by making the customers make the story. So I always had, as a saying, let the customer do the talking, not us. And actually, that I'm doing the same now. I'm now coaching about 30 people each year to become a data entrepreneur. So what is YETS? YETS stands for Euronymous Academy of Data Science. Now, Euronymous was a famous painter in the city where we are. So they call it the Euronymous Academy. And why is it unique? Because it's a combination of Eindhoven University, what Parvati is talking about, and Tilburg University. Eindhoven University is an engineering university, and Tilburg is an entrepreneurship university. And I said, data science is both, so why not combine our efforts and make it into a new academy where we will teach people on data entrepreneurship? And the funny thing is, it started in a monastery, so they had a huge building, and so what to do with this space? And they decided to bring in startup companies, to bring in large companies, to start a space for PhD people and PDN people, to start events. And one of the nicest things of the whole monastery is we have a great chapel. If you visit our website, you will see it. And that's where that's our biggest lecture room. And in between, there are a lot of rooms and places where we can meet. Everyone in this monastery is talking and thinking data science. And all the people that come in, they know we are in the middle of a hub. And that's great to be there. So that's also why I got in touch with Parvati, because we are sharing the same restaurant, and we are. When I needed someone to help us out on student support, I went up to the roof. I call it the Harry Potter roof. On top of the building was a great space, and there the PDN people are working. And we I got a lot of support from Parvati. It's better? This is fun? Okay. Okay, now I have to handle too. This is, yeah? Okay. Okay, but that's about the university. Now the story, I will build it up in 6 steps. First I will introduce a bit what is my vision on data science, or our vision. Then I will briefly touch sustainability, but you already know a lot about it, so I don't want to spend too much time on that. And then I want to cover what can data science do, what are the showstoppers, and what can data entrepreneurship do to make it happen. So first of all, what is data science? Well, most of the time we refer to this Davenport scheme, which talks about descriptive analytics or data science, predictive and descriptive. And those are the three levels from basic to advanced. Next to that, we always use the CRISP-AM model to show what you have to do for data science. First, you need some business understanding, then you need some data understanding, then you do some engineering and you do the analysis, you make a model. And when the model works fine, you can implement it. This is the theory, yeah? But this is not, there is no spirit in this whole thing. That's my feeling. So what we did, we added something. And we said, okay, in fact, we see data science as finding, checking, and applying insights from data. It's a very simple thing. There's no mathematics in there, but it's finding, checking, and applying insights with one goal: to improve decision making. So for us, if there is no decision making involved in data science, there is no impact. Yes, yeah, so, and I know a lot of data scientists who love the data, but are not in love with decision making. And then you can end up with a lot of frustration. So nothing happens with your data. Now, what is decision making? I use a special model for it. It's based on optimization. And decision making is combining goals with decision rules and data. When you combine these three, then you you have let's make a decision type of environment. And now the most important part for data science is the rules part. Everybody uses decision rules, and one of the things what data science can bring is adding decision rules, better ones. But what we have to know that in decision making, data is not the only input for decision rules. We also have our habits, our personal perceptions, our opinions. And those are competing with data. So if you want to make data science successful, you have to know your enemy. I always say my biggest enemy for data science is experience. Because I have experience, why should I adopt insights from data science? You know, you can tell me that you research my data from my company, and you say that you have some great things, you found some great things, but to be honest, I know better. I know all my people, I know all my customers and the data. No, that's just very small. So that's the competition between data science and real life. So you have to come up with real great insights to compete with protocols and perceptions. And now, if you really work on the insights, you can do a lot with data science. This is just a picture to show that you can do data science on the facts that you use, on the goals you use, on the rules you use, on the results you use. You can use it everywhere. And you can find insights and then put them in your system again, in your model, and then it starts improving. Okay? So this is just a basic way of working. Now, there is quite a big difference in data science if you focus on applying insights or finding them. When you work in finance and logistics and health, it's especially applying insights. A lot of insights already are found. And in that world, there is not much discussion about emotions and politics. It's really, well, straightforward, rational thinking. Now, there are a few topics where there is still not that much rational thinking. That's especially in social science, in marketing, in politics, and in sustainability. Yeah, there is not a straightforward rule that says when you do this, then that happens. Because you compete with opinions, feelings, habits. So that's very important to know. So before you can make data science work in those areas, you really have to be into the logics of the people behind it. So when I talk about data science and data entrepreneurship, what are the differences? Well, a data scientist loves to do research.
with a loop to find the insights. He collects, analyzes, and loves figures, quantitative insights. Now, the data entrepreneur has a broader view. He also is interested in making a business out of data, really making money. And he wants to discover opportunities with it. And he, next to quantitative things, he is still in for qualitative things. So he's not one single-minded. Okay, so what about sustainability? What is the connection with it, with the data entrepreneurship? Well, sustainability in these days is very simple. It's this picture. I think with the Paris Agreement, this was a great thing just to visualize all those goals. And I've never seen a government report this well-founded and designed that we all recognize straight away from one picture what we are talking about. That's a big step ahead. Now, with sustainability, there are some positive things. There are some trends, and I took them from a book. Sorry, I have to add my resources to this. But there has been a lot of progress in hunger, in poverty, and literacy in the world. Oh yeah, it comes from Johan Nørberg. It's called Progress. Since 1990 to 2015, all these things dropped by about 50%. So that's great. Good for sustainability. And life expectancy went up on average, let's say, from the 60s, from 50 to 70 years. So, wow, we should have a party. Big celebrations. But now, what is the real problem? That in the same period, our ecological footprint went in the wrong direction. We are burning the earth. And on average, the earth can have 2 hectares per person, but we are using on average now, I think about 4 or 5. It's too much, really, far too much. And that's not the only problem. Also, the split over the world is wrong. And what you see on the right side is in the red are the big spenders. And this is a map, by the way. It's mapping human development with ecological footprint. Now, you can think there is a line between using more footprint and having a better life, but that's not the case. There are countries on the right side top. They seem to have a good life and spending a lot, about 10 hectares per person per year. And there are countries at the bottom. They use 1 hectare per year, and they are doing bad. But there are also countries which only spend 5 hectares and have the same level of human development. There are even countries that have about 4 hectares. So there seems to be something wrong there. So there are some people spending a lot of resources, but not really improving their welfare anymore. And while you see US, Australia, Canada, they are on top. Holland is about 6.7. I'm not sure, but I think India is close to 2. And so it's not equal, it's not fair, it's not good. But there seem to be opportunities, because if you can make a high human development index with less footprint, there are good examples. And just to give you a more personal feeling, if you're wondering about your footprint, on average, it's 1/4 for housing, for heating and so on. It's 1/4 for food, 1/4 for mobility, and 1/4 for products and services you sell, you buy. So that's on average. So, but as you can see, in the US, they use 10 global hectares, in Germany and Holland about 6, and then, for example, in Argentina, 3. And then also the split is different. But this, to be honest, this made me moving. When I saw this picture, and I calculated my own footprint, then I got really shocked, by the way, because I had a lot on mobility, with flying to the US up and down. And so I said, well, I have to start moving, because I'm even worse than the US people. So I'm now close to 5 global hectares, by the way. So I moved a lot. I dropped from 15 to 5. And the main topic for sustainability in Holland is, by the way, is CO2. So it's the emission. And it's quite difficult to understand what the real problem is, because it's too much and there is an increase in temperature for 2 degrees. But what is the real issue? The real issue is that in the past, until 2000, we had an emission of 500 gigaton. The figure doesn't say much, but it's 500. Then since 2000 till now, in 20 years' time, we added about 400. So we are in our mission in those 20 years was almost as much as the 150 years before. That sounds terrible. And then if we don't want to have an increase more than 2 degrees, we still have a room for 500. Now, I calculated that there is room for 60 ton for each person on Earth, and I'm spending 10 ton a year. So in 6 years' time, my budget is gone. So that's a problem, big problem. So we have to do something about it. And of course, there is more fuel, so that's not a problem, but we cannot use that because then the CO2 will really bother us. So this is a sustainability, and can it be solved? Yes. For example, if we drive a car, only 20% of that energy is used for mobility. 80% is heating. So we should call a car a heater. It's not a car, you know, it's only 20% a car and 80% a heater. So then you should call it a heater, yes? Why not? And by the way, an electric car, is the efficiency is 90%. So if we take the energy from solar panels into the car, the problem is much less. And by the way, the energy of the sun in 1 hour is enough for the heating or for the energy of the whole Earth what we are using. So there is a problem and there is a solution. So what can we do about it? So we have a high level and we lack smart solutions and it's not equally split. Those are the three issues. So what is needed? We needed a mindset change, that we are aware of the problem better, that we develop better solutions, and that we change the resource balance. Now I'm talking about two things. What can change the mindset? And in my view, that's mainly data science, with coming up with the right facts and the right feedback. And we have to create new solutions. And that's not coming from data science. That's what we need data entrepreneurship for. So we will change the mindset, have better rules. So what can data science do? Already is doing. We can deliver the facts and give feedback to people. Because if we want to change habits, the most important thing is that you give feedback to people how they are doing. So that's something which is a good role for data science. In Europe, it's at this moment, for example, well done to have a kind of a smart meter in your house so that you at least become aware of the energy you're using. And so when I ask people how much kilowatt hours are you using, how much cubicles of gas, most people really don't know. They just pay and they say, well, it's a few hundred euros a year, so it's not a problem. So why should I bother? But now, slowly, people are starting to think, hey, what is this, all this discussion about? And by adding the smart meters, where you see what you're spending your energy on, people are becoming aware. And it's the same, by the way, in the car. You know, in the car, I can see how much fuel consumption I have. But it doesn't say yet how much CO2 I'm emission, what my CO2 emission is. So I'm in fact kept stupid. You know, in fact, you only should buy a car when it also says how much CO2 emission is in there. And the manufacturers are not that far yet. They are not doing this yet. What all countries are doing as a part of mindset change is indeed measure what's going on. And I saw some reports also about India and how you're doing. And so you're at least trying to measure, which is the starting point. It's great that you do that. And I know that a few people in the room here are also working on this. So I saw some reports. Thanks for doing that. A part of change in the mindset also that you make new laws based on the facts. In Holland, we decided that the farmers have to stop working partly because their emissions are too high. And somebody said in politics, we have to ask the farmers, half of them, to stop. Just one sentence. And then we had a revolution. And the farmers said, oh, we are not doing that. We take our tractors and we move up to a government city and we block the whole thing. It was a funny day, by the way. Everything was blocked. All the tractors were moving on the highway and they went into the city. It was completely blocked and everybody was aware, hey, there is something going on. And then people started to read, what is going on? Why do those farmers have to stop? And now we have a complete different thing. So sometimes you need to go a bit too far to get things moving. And now in politics in Holland, it's not about terrorism anymore or economic growth. It's all about climate change in this way. And thanks to data science, because they came up with the figures, they showed it's going wrong, and they said we need to change the law. So what is data science doing more? I know about the Pulse Labs, also one of them is based in Jakarta, and they are measuring what's going on with the Earth and with climate change and with disasters. There is also the Artificial Intelligence for Earth initiative, also collecting a lot of data, what's going on, and making people aware. And we at JATS, at our university, we also have taken some actions, because we have defined 6 initiatives to contribute to the development goals. One of them is digital health. And we had the interview yesterday with on health, how to do remote healthcare. We have some smart manufacturing initiative to improve smart use, smart production ways. Agro-food, about precision agriculture. I come back on that later. We have crime detection, where you can do better detection of things when they go wrong. Also about bribery. And then we have smart cities to make it more clean. And we have smart mobility. So we have professors on each of these subjects, and they have their own projects, their own labs to do improvements there. One of the special labs is the Zero Hunger Lab. It's an initiative to, together with the World Food Programme, to improve the logistics behind disasters. And when you have a disaster, you never know where it will happen, and you have some food in another place, and then you have to make sure that the food is moving into the right direction, and that you're splitting it up in the right way. And there is a lot of logistics behind there. And in the past, people said, okay, they need rice, they need this and that, and so they started moving all the stuff. But they changed their way of calculations and said people don't need rice, they need nutrition. So if it is rice, or it is maybe pasta, or it is something else, that's not that important, as long as the nutrition is okay. And by just changing the definition from types of food to nutrition, they made a saving of 20%. So they were able to be more efficient thanks to this other way of thinking. And by the way, the company I worked for, when there was a disaster, our people made a crash team, and they worked night and day and weekends to help World Food Program to do the logistics behind all these things, with helicopters, with ships, with trucks. And that was really a great thing to be part of. So the main thing we are, the Zero Hunger Lab is working on now, is improving the digital models, the logistic models, to do the disaster things and to prevent hunger. And they put them in models, and they share the models, by the way. So it's not a secret, it's really full transparency, thanks to data science. Now the question is, if we do all these things with data science, is it really making an impact? Are we really moving into the right direction? To be honest, no. Holland also made a commitment with the climate agreement that we should do things. I think we are 30% behind our targets, and the deadline is next year. So there is something going wrong. We know the figures, we know the urgency, and it's not happening. So what can we do? What should we do? Well, first of all, what are the showstoppers? There are 2 things wrong. That's the lack of right solutions. If, for example, we had the solar panels. They were too expensive for a long time. Now they are very cheap, so now we have a solution. But do we have the right cars? Do we have electronic cars? No. Do we have the right electricity generation? No. So there is something wrong there. And next to that, there is still some resistance. People know the facts, but they have still an emotional feeling, my neighbor is not doing anything, so why should I do it? And that's a bad thing. So the social pressure to improve living is not right yet. Now, there is talking about solutions. Who knows the book Drawdown? Only one? Okay, I brought a copy for all of you to have a look into it. But the book is great. It has about 100 solutions ready, defined with what is the impact of those solutions and what is the cost
and what are the benefits?
And it's quite an impressive book because it's really written out what the solutions look like. And it's out of the 100 topics, I just listed a few. For example, refrigeration. There is a lot of wrong stuff in there. Wind turbines is a good solution. Reduced food waste, plant-rich diets. 6 and 7 is quite interesting. It's about educating girls and family planning. And this shows that if we want to reduce the problem, we should prevent that we grow too fast. That's really part of the solution. And the last one is peatlands. In Holland, we are half peatland. And the peatlands is emission, there is an emission of 40 tons per hectare per year. Now, if you know that I, as a person, I have an emission of 2 ton, so I just have to buy peatlands, put it under the water, and I'm safe. Yeah? So, of course, that's a bit too simple as a solution, because then half of Holland will disappear. But it is a way of a solution to get our CO2 emission down. But okay, if we already combine the 7 plus number 13, we already go down 15 gigaton, which is already half of the world of the emission. So who is going to make this step? Who is going to implement these solutions on a short moment of time? Who's going to do that? Well, hopefully there is a solution. And indeed, data entrepreneurship, in my view, in our view, is a solution. Because it can create and implement solutions for sustainability. And I will explain how we do that. First of all, I want to explain what data entrepreneurship can do. When you have a company, it's always that you have some suppliers, your company, and you have customers. That's the basic flow. Now, what can you do with data entrepreneurship? You can improve your own processes. That's the most simple way. You just collect data about your processes, and you see where things are going wrong, and you make it dynamic, and you improve all the way with models, and decision making is improved. So that's one way. That's the most simple way. The second way has more impact when you start to use data to talk also to your suppliers and your customers. So that, for example, when you talk to your customers, and you supply them always with the same type of product, but maybe they are using half of it, or it's not really fitting. If you can make your product more flexible, more on demand, you can save a lot of stuff. Yeah, that's the same with food, that's the same with medicine. So if you can make your product more dynamic and more fit to the demand, that is saving a lot. For example, in food, there is a waste of 30% because it doesn't fit 100%. So more data, dynamic solutions, that's the second thing. The third way is if you add a new product to your solution. And for example, in Holland, we have the railways, and you always had to look into an old table when the train was driving. Now they added a very simple data-driven solution. They made an app in which you can exactly see when you're traveling where. And not only for the trains, but also for the buses, and even for cabs, you can add to it. And maybe it sounds simple, but in that way, the usage of the trains and the public transport has really boomed, because it's much more predictable. And for me, that's also about sustainability. Yeah, because if you drive the train, you save at least 30-40% of emission. And of course, the last line is data entrepreneurship when you start a new company. And on our university, we are focusing on that, but we are also happy with the other ways. So some other examples of data entrepreneurship is Tesla. It's not just a car, it's a data car. If you would skip the data in a Tesla, it wouldn't work. But what they also did is they combined the vision that the emission should go back. And you can do that by 50-60% by just moving to electricity. And I think they did a great job by showing the rest of the world it can be done. So for me, that's data entrepreneurship with sustainability impact. Another example is car sharing. Do people know? It's not Uber, but we call it in Holland Snapcar. So it's just a platform where people can tell when their car is available, and where people can look to hire a car from your neighbor in the same street. So you just register your car, you say when it is available, people look at it and they come by and they make it possible to rent a car. And the insurance is organized, the checking is organized, all the things are organized. It's a very simple solution, fully data-driven, very sustainable. This is one of the favorites, it's P for a T. Has anyone ever heard about P for T? Or maybe P for beer can also be done. This is really a mind shift thing. Because in the world, there is a sanitation problem and there is a water problem. Well, both are combined, there is water involved. Now what people did develop, just based on the facts, they knew that it should be possible to make clear water from urine and from some from waste, and that you even have fertilizer coming out of it. And they put the whole thing just in a container. So on one side of the container, you're going to the toilet, and the other side, there is fertilizer coming out of it and clean water. Now, this is against our minds, yeah? This is upsetting us, thinking, hey, this is not possible. Now, we are used that it is not possible from the past, but with the current situation, we can do it. And they started to introduce this on festivals in Holland. And they showed that it was possible. But of course, the real usage is not in Holland, it's in Africa or in those places where they have a lack of water and they have a problem with sanitation. So I think this is an excellent example of sustainability development and real solutions which are missing sometimes. Does someone want to order one? Not yet? Yeah? How many?
Couple.
Sorry?
So I represent Sustainability Innovation Center, yeah. And I would very much like this to be implemented there.
Okay, good, okay. So again, this is maybe it doesn't sound like data entrepreneurship, but it is in the end, yeah, because it's really improving sustainability and it's really driven on data that this should be possible. Another nice example is about life cycle analysis. Who knows about life cycle analysis? Okay, more hands moving on. And because part of becoming aware is that you know what is the impact of a bottle of Coke compared to just water from the tap. And what is the impact of meat compared to tofu? And so you need to know more about making choices. And this is one of the initiatives in Holland where they are selling all the impact stuff on groceries. I also looked for one example here in India, of course, it's remote health diagnosis. So it's also a great example of improving one of the sustainability goals. Now, some other examples, precision agriculture, so that you don't need chemicals for all the area, but you really can spot it on just where the plants are or where the things are going wrong. This is saving about 80% of the chemicals. Personalized medicine, that's quite a nice thing, eh? We all are different, but on a when you take medicines, it says when you're above 12, you should take one pill or two pills or whatever. But in reality, that's a very bad advice, because we have a different weight, we have a different circumstance, but still we use that stuff. So if I use too much, it's bad for my body. Yeah, because it's more breaking me down than helping me. So if you can change that into personalized medicine, that can already save 40% of the medicines, also in the waste. So this is really a great thing. And we have a professor on this, personalized medicine, and he was promoted in personalized marketing. And this is the great thing of data science, that you can learn from one discipline and use it in another. Glass houses, we have a lot of emission. If you blow that emission into a glass house, it is used by the plants to grow. So now we are transporting from factories the CO2 into the glass house, and we have better crops coming out of it. We never thought about that before. It's a very simple solution. So, aquaculture, I'm not sure if you are aware of that you can do in a glass house. You put the seed in the water, and all the only thing you need is of course nutrition and CO2, And because there is no soil involved, there are no bad animals there, so you don't need any chemicals. Really, it's a huge step ahead. And of course, you have to control it very well and measure very well. But you can find models and then you can share them how to do it. In Holland, we have now restaurants which have a very dynamic menu because they only cook from leftovers from retail shops. So if in the retail shop the stuff is out of date, becoming out of date, they ship it in the afternoon to the restaurants and then the restaurants make a menu out of it. And if you know that about 15% of the retail shops is leftovers, and they want to get rid of it, but they can't, so they have to throw it away. Now they are using it in restaurants. And it's great. You just need a system for that, data-driven. Who has what? Who can need what? Okay, let's bring it there and let's make some great meal out of it. It's very popular, by the way. And of course, we have done a lot on the recycling of furniture and textile and electronics. And these maybe seem not to be, you know, that impressive, but it really helps enormously. And this is also what we educate our people. But don't think too original, just think close to where you are and make it happen. Now, why is Yacht doing this and how are we doing this? Just a simple list of things. First of all, I'm responsible for professional education. We have people from companies coming in and they have to do a graduation project and the graduation project has to be a startup. So they have to define in their business where can you do business focused on data, entrepreneurship and sustainability. And they have to do it with a few colleagues together and they have to come up with a minimum viable product in about 6 months' time. Really data driven, they have to do some analysis, they have to deliver their models. And we coach them. And it's really very motivating to work with these people. What we do in this environment is we have a lot of pitches. As soon as they come in, they have to pitch why they joined this education program. And at least once a month, they have to pitch again. And we make them fail fast. The sooner you fail, the better you learn, the more you learn. If you don't fail, you don't learn. And you do it in a secure environment. It's very trustworthy. We are not there to kill you. We are not there to take your money. We are just there to improve your ID. And so we have a small booth in the middle of the canteen at Yachts. And people can just go there and pitch their story to whoever is there. So that's great. So we have a proof of concept lab and a playground where people can sit together and discuss things. And we even do it after lecture. So we have a lecture from 9 till 5. And after lecture, I invite the people to stay, bring their data, bring their ID, and just work on. We take care of the food until 10 o'clock. No problem. This is not what people are used to on school, you know, not on Friday afternoon. On Friday afternoon, you go to the pub and have a good weekend. But we go on. So that's the atmosphere. We have a small and medium enterprises data lab where small companies can come in and ask for help from data scientists. And it's a small fee, only €2,500. And then you get a support for 2 weeks from two students guided by a professor to see what can data science do for your company. And there are really great results coming out of from improved products, improved processes. We have startup facilities in the building. So if you want to start up your own company, you can rent a place there. In a good environment, so you don't have to sit somewhere in a gray building with no data scientists around you. You can really start in an environment where you feel good. We have back to school meetings. When people have finished the program, we don't let them go. We ask them to come back again and again and again, because maybe one quarter has a great idea after the program and they really start in that. And maybe one quarter needs a half year extra, and maybe another quarter needs another 1.5 year extra. But if we ask them back, they feel committed. They feel, hey, I have to do something because I'm asked back to tell what I did. I have to prove that I did something. And this is a very small thing. Just one day in half a year that they come back and they have to talk about their project. And that is really making a big change. And then we have the ecosystem, what I refer to, the monastery with the startup companies, the big companies, the students, the PhD people, everywhere, everybody around them. And one of the things we learned them is in the class that it's not enough just to listen and repeat and put on paper what you learned, but the main thing is that you have to be able to apply what you learned. You have to show that you can apply it in a new area. You have to show that you are able to add something to a concept, and you have to show that you are able to create a new concept. So it's not passive learning, it's very active learning. Another example of what we do in a university is a hackathon. In this case, it was about searching for rhinos, and how can we prevent that the poachers are getting these rhinos. So, yeah, start collecting data where there, where there is no data, come up with very creative ideas. And what the team who was winning, they also were able to do the implementation. Another example is cities, where we measure the noise and the happiness on the faces of the people. We have certain areas where a lot of people drink and have parties, but sometimes there are fights. And now we have to learn how to make a difference between people gathering around singing a song or having a fight. And you can hear that from the noise. You can see it from the movements. So we are learning now how we can use that. Maybe it's a bit close to what is happening in China, of course. So there is a big difference how you do that, how to keep privacy in line. But this is what we do it in the European way. Also on large events, we have a lot of events in Holland, a lot of music events. And people want to feel secure there. We want to see if there are no drugs are being used. And there also we have to do it in a very decent way that we control the people and find out what's going on. I'm not sure if the container is here, but it should be the P4T container. So to give you an end of advice is please treat sustainability as a business. Maybe it sounds bad, because we are here as many people are in education or NGOs, but to take it seriously, you have to make it into a business, because if you make it into a business, it will be sustainable. It's just part of being a business. And luckily, in Europe, more and more consumers are asking for sustainable products and ways of working. So that's the good news. So if you're not sustainable, people don't buy your stuff anymore. So I really hope that also the oil companies will experience that. So now, of course, the finishing question is, what can you do? What can we do? Of course, first of all, keep becoming a data scientist, because that's the basics. If you have the figures right, you can do a lot. Become a data entrepreneur, it's an extra step. It's a risky thing, because entrepreneurship is about uncertainty and risk. And focus on creating solutions, not just stories, but solutions. Okay. There are some people in education here, so what can you do? Well, I hope that you get inspired by our program to combine all those things and challenge people on creating solutions. Maybe two things to remember today. If we want to make awareness, data science is fine, but if we want to change the world, we need data entrepreneurship. So, I hope that this story adds to your story and that you are convinced about the fact that data cannot save the world, but data entrepreneurship can. So please join us in this travel and make data entrepreneurship happen.